Hello and welcome to this live coding session where we will be creating a dynamic shipping calculation for an e-commerce site. This is part of the ongoing project for the Western Friend magazine, where we've been porting over this Drupal website to Python and Django using the Wagtail content management system. All of our source is available on GitHub, sorry. And hosting this session as part of a community called Code Buddies. It's a community of teachers and learners. We work together to improve our coding skills, sharing knowledge, and building projects together. Code Buddies platform is also open source on GitHub. It's a nonprofit organization, non-commercial. So without further ado, let's go ahead and dig in. We've got this bookstore. And when we add items to the carts, I have a bug. I'm in the middle of this. This is carrying over from a previous. Series, but it's essentially we're in the middle of a work. I had to leave off in the middle to give myself some headspace, figure out the way forward. But essentially, we have a cart. The cart is functional, and I'm adding shipping calculation to the cart. So let's hop over here. So pardon me, I've been away from the stream for a while. Haven't been working on this project for a couple weeks now. So I'll be a little bit bumbly here while I get oriented. But this is a live coding session, so that's to be expected. Mistakes will be made. Okay, so we're working in our branch, and we're working on what are called orders. In order to put together an order, you need multiple products. And now we're adding a shipping component to the order. And the shipping component will be used both in the cart view and on the order summary to actually save the order. Make it a little bit of tea to start off the session. So let's go take a closer look at this error so I can get back into the swing of it. Essentially, I'm trying to add an item to the cart, and I changed the data model a little bit, and I'll explain that as we take a look at it. But we can go to cart.py. So if I go to our cart, and this might even have, if I look at the diff here, you can see what's being changed. I suppose this is just a black. Our code style guide is linting the code here, but more or less what's happening is that when somebody adds an item to the cart and they convert that cart to an order, in other words, they proceed with making an order, we want to take a snapshot of the product at the time they ordered it. This is because products can change over time, namely the prices might vary. And we want our historic invoices to reflect the price at the time the item was ordered. So what we're doing here is actually getting attributes from the product at the time it's going into the cart and saving those. What I also need to do is create a foreign key relationship to the product so that it can render in the template and a few other things. So that's where I'm in the middle of right now. Each item in the cart is the cart is a dictionary itself, or it inherits from a dictionary or object, actually. But it's a keyed by product ID, and then we've just put a dictionary for each product ID. with those static attributes. Now I need to go back here and add, if we look back at the error here, product object is not subscriptable. So let's go and see if this is in line 30 of cart.py. Okay, so what's happening here? It's trying to get a property of product, which should be passed in here. And it didn't complain, this is weird. It didn't complain about it on line 26. Got the ID from it. It's complaining on line 30 when it's trying to access the title. That's the funny part. So it's able to actually get the product ID. Okay, so maybe that was the problem. I should be accessing it. A little bit confused, and this is a. I'm not sure really how to explain that because I don't know what the difference is in accessing the property through dot notation using versus using kind of a dictionary lookup. Looking for the key. Okay, now this error is coming from our template. It's not pointing to the exact line, but this is where I left last time. Page URL. So when our cart is rendering products, it's going to try to use Wagtail's internal template tag to create links to the page. And that template tag is called page URL. So let's go check out the cart detail template and find where we're using this page URL. Places. And here's, I believe, the line in question. So this product that's being passed into the cart is not a Wagtail page instance. In fact, it's nothing or else an empty string, one of the two. So I believe, if just for experimental purposes, comment those out. No, I'm not sure if that comment will work properly. Okay, so I've just got to trace this a little deeper in my code that is passing this empty string. I'll come and uncomment this in a moment. But when we look, I reverse my. Add one to the cart. Firstly, let's just carry the product forward. I believe our model should accommodate that. If I go to the We don't have a model here, so I should actually just delete this file. Our cart doesn't store things in the database. It's an ephemeral storage. It's session-based. So we'll delete that file. Videos, forms. Need to come back to tests. Please ignore that. And we've got some views. I believe this might be where we're getting the error with the URL resolver looking for product ID. So I'll leave this tab open. Let me just double check my orders model. Again, I have been away from this code for a while, so I'm trying to get back up in speed. So each order consists of some customer details, all of this, for mainly shipping reasons, all of these fields. And one more items. Okay, here we are. So this is the, these are the static attributes, product title and product ID, and price and quantity. All of those are preserved at the time. They're like a snapshot preserved at the time of creating the product. I don't have a field any longer for a product, which would be the foreign key field. So I need to do that. And for simplicity, I'm going to refer to this open source project that we've used as inspiration for this. It's on GitHub. It's there it was, packed Django 2 by example. It's a really great book I've been using. All the source code for the book is openly available, and MIT licensed. And in this book, you learn to build several projects that, ooh, it's on offer right now. And honestly, this subscription at 9 or 10 bucks a month is a really good deal. There's a lot of other books unpacked. I've been enjoying kind of starting to get into Flutter development, for example. And then in this book, we build an online shop, and there's other projects like an e-learning platform and a social media sharing website and a blogging application. And they give you a very concrete examples using Django 2, so the code's pretty up to date. So I highly recommend this book. It's not a paid endorsement. It's really been beneficial to help us move far and fast down the road to building our own e-commerce solution. I think we're in chapter 8, my shop. If I just look at the, I deviated from the book because we're using Wagtail and several other things are slightly different. But if I look at their orders model, the book uses a foreign key relation with order items and products. So this is what I'll essentially add back. They do take a snapshot of the price and quantity at the time of purchase. I thought that the title might be subject to change and the product ID might also be subject to change. So I maybe naively just separated those out into their own attributes. This foreign key should be more or less sufficient. You'll get the title, the current title, which might be confusing if somebody gets an invoice and the title has changed from the book they ordered 6 months ago. Okay, let me just double check. So there's product coming in here. We're still working on the cart. We're still checking out details, so we're not going to commit either of those. I need to just trace this through. Again, since we were borrowing code from this book, I don't have a really great understanding of how some of the particulars, the reasoning behind some of the particulars. I'm understanding more how it works, but this cart.py, for example, why some of the code is written how it is a little bit mysterious to me. It wasn't fully explained in the book what edge cases it was trying to prevent. Of want to check out what this product is, and that should not be a capital. Automatically do that for me. Let's just check out what type it is. I'm gonna close the code buddy. I'll leave it open just so we can do attribution in a moment. The bookstore. Watch the console down here when I add the cart. Okay, so what do we got right off the bat? So this argument is not coming through here. I might need to check. Why this view and this button particularly? Okay, it's a form, it's submitting. Classes, but it's submitting this form quantity, and for some reason the product ID doesn't seem to be in the form data. Okay, so let's step back one step further. This could be the core issue. So this, we need to go to the store templates. This add to cart is shared. Just take a quick look inside here. See what the string representation of this product item looks like. All right. See what the ID is. Is there. Okay, so then we'll have to jump to the view. So yeah, this didn't really change, this code didn't really change anyway. So that makes sense. So we're going to go. These buttons weren't so pronounced. I don't have the view open. Okay. Let's see if the product ID is here. Yeah, those are all, the product ID is there, the product is there, this is the string representation of the product, and it's a type. So yeah, all three of those checks pass. I suppose I should be just doing this in debug mode, but okay. So now I think the problem is here. No reverse match for add with arguments something. confusing part is it's actually getting into that view. It's logging. Like it's resolving to this view, this card add view. And I'm getting a weird error for the, I think this card add, I think the error is coming here, but card detail, card is card. This is just a, I don't think the reason, this is just attaching the field, the form, the entry form, the update. I believe these errors are just red herrings. There's something else going on that is not obvious to me. I wish I could get rid of this. This card add. So I believe this is working up to here. And this should be fine. Oops. Something about these Django HTML templates, it doesn't really know how to parse them properly. Save it as, or indicate that it's regular HTML. Emit will work and prettier will even take effect. So what I'll do is just grab this foreign key, I'll add this to the order item product. This is a dangerous one. I don't know if this is the case. So what I'm believing this would do is if we delete in the product, it'll delete all orders associated with that product. I don't think that's a good idea. We should set null or something else. In other words, those orders would have been fulfilled and they're financial transactions. I don't believe they should just be deleted. You know, not all of them would have been paid. There's a let me think here for a second. Order item, excuse me. Yeah, this would be order items that would be deleted. When deleting a product, I don't think that's a good formatting goes the other way. Error name product is not defined. Okay. Okay, so yeah, I just have to allow that field to be nullable. Sometimes black's a little bit inconsistent whether it wants shorter line length. Anyway, I'm not gonna fight it. This is weird. I'm just trying to think. This is sort of a wagtail thing. Because this clusterable model. Field product ID clashes with the field product. Let's see if there's a little missing migration there. Nope. I'm just not gonna be able to add that foreign key. All right. there's less moving parts here. So if we have the product dot ID, I think we will always have the product, so we would always have the ID, so that's one thing. Everything's all of this, the whole thing was working a little bit ago. Let me look at the implementation here. This is probably where I'm getting closer to a breaking change I made. So they're getting all the products, get cart products is a method I made, which essentially takes this out. Get product, so grabs the IDs and returns them. So I just factored this into a function. Copies it for product and products. Here's the thing. So it's iterating over those. This is the change I thought was unnecessary, but it turns out I was probably mistaken. So let me go back to that. Closer to this and just chalk it up to misunderstanding. So we've got the products for product and product. Cart product ID. So we got the cart. Because I show this ID field. Okay, so I gotta be careful with that. It's just kind of verbose code. I'm trying to remove as much code as possible. And I thought by adding the product to the item, it would mitigate the issue. Or it wouldn't have to have this redundant loop grabbing the product from the database, but that's turned out not to be the case. So that was my mistake. So we'll grab that. And then you just attach it. So for that, so for each product, we're just popping it into the cart, so it has a copy of the product, and this is iterated on the server side, so it's not serialized and sent to the client. Now that we've got the product, the product ID should not be missing anymore. We just put this static. We have to typecast. All right, well, let's see if this is an improvement. If we go back, Bookstore. Product ID is not. All right, at least we got a different error. Good stuff. And this is probably just because I need to access the property directly. Cart 32. And this needs to be stringified, which is why the product. So much noise. That makes sense. I can do that. It's funny the price would be stringified there. Seems unnecessary. I'm gonna introduce another bug probably. Cool. Hey, I like this. Key error, exception value 6. That's key for product 6 if I add a different product. Product 7. Okay, good. And this is because I'm looking for an identifier starting. So that's just this code right here. Let's use the stringified version of that. All right, cool. I think we're on the right trail. Now let's see what my, oh goodness. Object of type decimal is not JSON serializable. JSON serializable. So this is the reason we had to do that there, okay. Good, oh man, that feels good. Got the cart working. And it only has one item because all those other inserts failed. All those other times we tried to add a product to the cart, just throwing exceptions. Okay, let me just try to change the quantity. All right, so everything's working. What you'll notice here is we have previously, if you've seen other work in this series, we've just had the total cost, but now we have a subtotal, which is the unit price multiplied by the quantity, and we have a flat rate shipping. It's literally just returning 10 and summing those up for the grand total. The reason this whole pull request is in progress is to create a shipping rule and then have that factored in. So now that we've got things basically working, I'll just commit these changes. We will proceed. I can check real quick if the checkout process works. This is because I did want to include the product for the order item, but for whatever reason the database, I couldn't add that field to the database. It was conflicting. So working. do have a title, ID, price, and quantity, and this ID lets me fetch the product. And this is all working. Create order. So now we're back in black. We if I log in. Test user, hop to the Wagtail admin. We go to our store orders. Someone else ordered 10 of faith and practice. Boom. Okay, good to go. Order item model, I do need to put this back. Field panel, product title. So we can see what product it is and manage those orders. I'd like to have a read-only field panel. Oops. I wonder if they just got added to the Wagtail core. So I just won't fuss with it for now. I've noted the discussion. So it's not part of the core yet. So this just needs to be a field panel. Which means that this can be edited and cause confusion, but okay. We want the product and quantity to be modifiable in case somebody changes their order or makes a mistake I don't know. I'm not gonna go too far out on a limb here. Main thing we're here to do now is commit these things that are now working. For consistency, I should just be using that product ID field there. Darn it. No red squiggles. Basically the same commit. How do I append? I think we can use this get lens now. Just use Atom, I think. And there was this nice way of appending a commit. Whatever. All right, cool. I think everything's good to go now. Now we're gonna hop over and do the calculation for shipping and try to wrap this session up in this feature. So we have a shipping module, which doesn't really have much except a shipping calculator and just a definition, an app definition. And right now it just returns a flat 10 decimal quantized for human readability. Basically it's a currency. So we're just seeing currencies with two decimal places. So what we gotta do, and luckily I've thought it out a little bit. If we hop over some products, hop over to the orders. Interesting thing here. Is it's going to be used in the cart and the order. That's the challenging part. Actually, should probably just be calculated in the cart and not changed. After the fact. Let me check the order model to see if I'm trying to do a dynamic calculation there. Order. So firstly, this should be called items. So that's passed in there. I'm not sure that the shipping cost should be dynamic at the point where the order's been stored in the database. Thinking that it should be a static field in the order and calculated dynamically when we're displaying it in the cart. Because shipping rules are tending to change as well. Not very frequently, but it's possible. All right, so let's bring up the cart. Yeah, I think I'll just add another field here. And if that's the case, I'll move the, excuse me, I'll move the shipping module into the cart. It doesn't need its whole own app. I'll talk to Mary about this, but I believe that shipping should be done at checkout time, the shipping calculation, and then stored as part of the order. Here we have the products, and these products are actual product instances. But the important thing to note if I will have more specific product types available. That way I'll be able to determine if it's a book or just a generic product. I'll have to figure out some way of determining whether each product is a book. That's funny, they printed it twice. So for now, what I could do. I'll go back to the cart. So when I'm passing this, instead of grabbing products here, could grab the books. Because I know it's books. And right now we don't have other product types. This is a lazy solution there. Other book types. Because it works. Not the best. Yeah, I still don't understand why it's, and this is actually going to be problematic, why it is, printing twice. When there's just one. Okay, so it's just looping twice. Well, that's not a big deal. It's being called twice. All right, so essentially. We're gonna take this count of books. I suppose the solution would be in here. I can check. I don't know how to check whether each page type is a book. That's the problem. I think I might have to do it out here just as a way passing. The correct data type in there. So in other words, explicitly coding each of these, yeah, that might be okay. I'm just gonna open up a reference document for these flat rate shipping rates, shipping costs. Do this in another tab. close there. Let me go ahead and log in over here. Okay, now we're just going to check the back end, the structure for the store, configuration, shipping, calculation rules. And what we did was broken into brackets. I think the Pythonic way, so, the Pythonic way would be use if else if. I believe they don't have a switch in the language. And I'm not sure if there's a just like a more sort of elegant way of doing it, this approach than hard coding it with these switches. So, okay. I'm open to feedbacks via the comments, the YouTube comments or otherwise. So let's just start one book. I should have made a little bit of a table here. It's like half off, 75%. Okay, I'll. That's what's changing here is the discount multiplier. Does Python have a between operator? SQL. Yeah, I mean this. Looks pretty clean. Yeah, this is cleaner. I like that. If number is in range. Just check the Python range operator. Or function or whatever. Python range function. And I can't use it. Well, if it's greater than 16. It's a little confusing, but okay. You just have to know the range operator doesn't include that. I think it's $3 a book. Thank you. so for some reason the boot count, this condition doesn't get triggered. Okay, no, that's correct. I need the quantity. Okay, so I have to sum the quantities. Know if this is just. Let me see how bad this looks. Kesty. Book object has no man. Okay, this is the crux of the issue. Let me just see what this book is. That's the problem, is this I'm not passing the quantity here. So it's a logical error. I'm not understanding and writing the code correctly. So I need to get this quantity field for each of those products, but only for the ones that are books. That's the challenging part, is I don't have a clean way. Sort of checking the entity type. Could make the assumption that everything in here is going to be a book because we don't have any other product types. And that's just basically punting the issue to my future self. I don't always like having to do that. Specifically when I. Just need to get it done. So we do have items self. Let's see, so I'm gonna do a list comprehension. Change this calculator to take a quantity. Defaulting to one. Okay, so accessing self.card in these other cases. And 21 get folks ship. Okay, because I have 31 items, so it's free shipping. Very good. Let's try putting it down. Let's start with one item. $3. Two items. $4.50. Five items. Very cool. We need to add a shipping cost field to the order to preserve that, and then that can be manually overridden. Very good, it's working good. Let's go and commit these changes while they're fresh. Thank you. stretch. We're going to do the orders model, add a new field. To duplicate a little bit of code here. Yeah, actually, I don't need to duplicate the code because it's going to be a field now. So when I created the order, It's saving the order right there. So it needs to have the shipping cost before that occurs. It has to come into the form. This is a little more tricky than I thought. Essentially, I've got to pass this shipping cost into the form. But not as a field that's visible to the user. Let's put the shipping cost on a different level, but I think the shipping cost belongs on the order. Under in it. How do I pass the value though? I guess there's a property on here I can put the value in there, I hope. So that hides it. How do we set the value of the field? Fly right 10 and see if this works. From here I would need again to calculate the length. All I have is the field. This is a really tricky deal. Or I could do it here, form. Actually, I think I should do it here. So the shipping cost is there. Leave this form code as it is. I'm done here. And basically, I'll do the save at the end. I can't do it at the end, but. Just like this product approach here, passing in all the items. Actually, wait. We have the cart here. So then we can just use the method on the card. I hope I've got my code well enough organized to not have to duplicate these things. Yeah, very good. All right. Cool. So we had a shipping cost, which haven't been added yet. So actually, let's clear this out. Python create migration. Make migrations. Again, it's been a while since we've been doing Django stuff. Trying to add a non-nullable field shipping costs in order without default. Null represented in Python. I was just seeing if we could do an arithmetic one with null, if we'd throw an exception. Got that migrated in. To add it to the UI. Shipping cost field is there actually, probably doesn't even need to be there. Because in the view, we are adding the shipping cost to the form and then saving it. Okay, the form. Why not save unless this is there? So I probably need to do the shipping cost first, then check the validity, then save it. It's not the answer I ended up going with, but it looks like a upvote worthy answer. I'll go ahead and give it the updates. So what do we got here? Got some items. Shipping cost is calculated correctly. does shipping cost to, if I can just add it directly on there, or if I should attach it to the post or some kind of So it's like getting to the f form save. It seems like it's valid. It's getting inside of the validity check. Shipping cost. Shipping cost seems correct. Order, clusterable model. Let's see what the output of this is. Yeah, it's there. Order create form object. Has an attribute cleaned data. All right. Let me double check. This is from a little while ago. All right. Let's just try that. The data. So I guess the clean data gets set in the validation. So you have to set it, append it to the raw form data first. All right, let's check it out. See if this works. Oikeste. In a way, that's what's happening here. We're creating the form, we're initializing the form. I know this shipping cost part's working, so I'll just take that out. I'll just actually replace that with the comment. Orders view, order create. That's where I'm at. It's returning none. This is incorrect. Maybe it's not getting into the see if this value, if I can set the value here and get it to save to the database first. So yeah, it's not returning anything. It's not getting into the, it's not passing validity, so it's not valid. This is immutable at some point. This is really recent. Okay, form.initial. So it's the other way around. Form.initial. Shipping cost. Didn't check the validity. It's quite tricky. Let's try this. This I think we're still can use this positional argument. Oh, there we go. I believe I double checked here that I can get the shipping cost. Had some troubles just setting the initial value. There it is. Okay. Why wouldn't it be valid? All right, shipping cost is empty. Set this. Here's where I need to do it actually. So before the post, grab the cart, we initialize the order create form. At that point, we can. Initialize the shipping cost, which is part of the form. It's a hidden field. So I'm just going to do this in the correct order. I think this should be the case. The cart's still available because it gets passed into the template context, so we can render out the contents of the cart. Up here, so let me just refresh this page. Okay, so that was the problem. I just needed to initialize the shipping cost prior to, or the first time the form is created, and then it gets passed in here. It should have the shipping cost there. It's an array. That's an interesting thing. It's an array. I guess all of the values are lists. Oh boy. Before I save this, I just want to submit that order. Let's go take a look. Oops. The order is now. Go to Wagtail admin. Ooh, minor update is available. Store orders. We've got a please work order. If I edit the order, we have the shipping cost. Alrighty then. That's basically the milestone we were after. Get the shipping costs working. I'll improve this template later to include the total and subtotal and shipping costs. See if I can clean the code a little bit. I think otherwise it's pretty good though. I need to check though. Because we're relying on the client, to be honest, here. Somebody might want free shipping. Should be able to wait to do it at runtime prior to saving the form. I don't understand why that was so difficult. This is good to go. Inside here, once the form has been validated, or inside the post block at the very least, order create a form. Let me check. I need to check out, so mobile mode. How do I get out of that? Well, whatever. Let's just say I want to put 300. I'm really feeling generous with my shipping. Yeah, of course, because you can modify the page template. So get free shipping in the case, in the abuse case. I don't need the dynamic initial value, I need to change the value at runtime. So I want free shipping. Well, let's just make it really, again, obvious. Hey Gunshine Stat, thanks for the subscribe or the follow. Appreciate it. Sorry if we've had a little bit of bandwidth issues with the broadcast. Validation errors didn't appear. That's a good sign. Store. Expensive shipping shouldn't have 123. It does. Man. I can't believe there's not a way to modify this form data at runtime. Let's create another one. Just be a user that's gonna get free shipping. Hey, welcome back to the stream. Sorry for the bandwidth issue. Seems like my internet got interrupted briefly. Zeroing in on how to modify Django forms at runtime, basically the form contents. So I have this hidden field here, and I realized that hiding the shipping cost just allowed, the user to, a savvy user to actually modify it. So let's say they're feeling generous and want to pay a high shipping cost. Just to make this obvious. It's immutable. That's the problem. Well, let me change it. this should have a proper shipping cost, even though the user was able to manipulate the template. This 456 has the proper shipping cost. Okay, that's good. All right, let me just put this in there. This might be unnecessary now, since we're doing this before the validate step. All right, let's see if that's the case. Less is more. Less code I have, the easier it is to understand. So I add this to cart. It's $3, and I'm cheap. I want to actually get free shipping. Let's see if it works. I didn't make any modifications. Okay, that'll work. And essentially, if the shipping cost has been calculated correctly, should show up in the back end under free shipping, but it won't actually be free shipping. $3. All right. So boiled down to, I needed to make a copy of this. Otherwise, it's immutable. Okay. New lesson learned. Okay, we'll commit. So that's a cleanup. I just had an empty paragraph there. So I think that's about it. It's been almost 2.5 hours. There was a little bit of struggle going on in this session with figuring out how to modify the cart contents, the form contents, in a form that had been instantiated. Worked through that. And then just a little bit of kind of getting back in motion with the refactorings I was doing to the whole checkout process involving the cart in products and things like that. So had I have been in more of a, you know, continual development cadence, I think it would have been a little bit quicker to get this stuff done today. But that's all right. Just it is what it is. If you're interested in building your own e-commerce website, you can check out our source code on GitHub. We have many other features. We have an online library and an online magazine, and several parts for this online store. And if you're wanting to, learn to code or hang out with some people who are also on a learning journey, highly recommend this Code Buddies website. Again, it's a all-volunteer group, nonprofit organization, non-commercial, no advertisements. It integrates with Slack and Hangouts and other means of live collaboration. It's peer-to-peer. We're all teachers and learners. And if you just want to be quiet, you can hang out with people, or there's often opportunities to learn from teachers or collaborate. And all sorts of hangouts scheduled for many different languages and kind of projects. And here's the schedule I'm doing right now. And Code Buddies is also under work. The platform itself is open source. We're currently working on several prototypes for the next version of Code Buddies with Node.js, serverless, and Django. It's just a few examples. We don't know which will be the sort of final solution. We're just doing a technology tour. Okay, well, that's been another episode of creating a website from scratch with Python, Django, and the Wagtail CMS. Really appreciate everybody who's stopped by in the chat. If you're checking this out on YouTube, I'll try to quickly respond to any questions or comments you had below the video. Thanks again for watching, and have a great day.